that old school feeling of what is arena shooter, four players on each team, controlling weapons on map, controlling the map itself, your teammates being in the right position.
The beta will run from December 29th through January 18th for a period of 3 weeks.
We have 7 maps, we have 3 modes, 11 sandbox weapons that are going to be included, and 7 armor sets that you'll be able to customize your Spartan with.
Looking at small maps that are really tailored to 4v4 combat. We've also got fair start, so what that means is no one's going to have a different loadout than the other person. Every member of red team is going to be the same as every member of the blue team. We've got 60 frames per second, which is going to be awesome. Just a blistering pace of we're going to have dedicated servers. All these things are really going to support our goals for fostering that competitive gameplay.
We want the Halo Channel to be this great complimentary experience with the beta. So it's not just for us to be able to push entertainment to you, it's also for the viewer and the player to kind of give information back to us. We'll be running all of this programming leading up into the beta and throughout the beta, but you'll also be able to unlock some things in the beta that you'll actually be able to carry forward into Halo 5 Guardians.
Anytime you're putting something out there that you're working so hard on, it's always nerve-wracking to have the first time anybody gets hands-on with that experience, but it's also invigorating. And so we're all just really excited to get online and play with the fans and hear their feedback to help make Halo 5 Guardians the best game it can possibly be.
There's one franchise that has established itself in the face of epic storytelling and multiplayer gaming on Xbox, and that's Halo. This holiday, the Master Chief Collection offers gamers incredible value. 4 phenomenal games, the live-action Halo Nightfall series, and Halo 5 Guardians multiplayer beta, all in one package, only on Xbox One. Our goal today was to show you our continued commitment to make Xbox One the best place to play games this holiday. Games like Assassin's Creed Unity, Call of Duty Advanced Warfare, FIFA 15, Grand Theft Auto 5, Destiny, Minecraft, Sunset Overdrive, Forza Horizon 2, Halo the Master Chief Collection, and more. We also announced 3 exclusive holiday bundles that represent incredible value and choice for Xbox fans. The Call of Duty Advanced Warfare bundle, the Sunset Overdrive white console, and for fans here in Europe, FIFA 15. All 3 bundles are available for pre-order today. And we showed you continued commitment to bringing the best exclusives to Xbox One in 2015 and beyond. It was incredible to see the demo from Remedy for Quantum Break on the first time on stage here. It was also an honor to have Daryl Gallagher announce that Rise of the Tomb Raider will be joining the list of Xbox exclusives in holiday 2015. But it doesn't end there. You have told us you want more choice in how you purchase games, and we're delivering. I'm pleased to announce that we will be bringing one of your most requested features to Xbox One, the ability to pre-order and pre-download selected titles to your console. Xbox One owners will be able to pre-order and pre-download Forza Horizon 2 prior to its official release on September 30th, so you are ready to play as soon as it launches. More titles will also be available in the coming months, including FIFA 15. It's worth repeating. It's an incredible time to be an Xbox One gamer. For those of you here at the briefing, you'll get a chance to play some of the games we showed you today and talk directly to the developers. For those attending Gamescom this week, we hope that you will come to the Xbox booth where you can play some of these amazing games for the first time. And for everyone who watched us online today, you can stay connected to Gamescom's daily updates and events this week, including the briefing after show on your Xbox, on Xbox.com, and on Twitch. Thank you for your time today. But most of all, thank you for playing on Xbox One and constantly giving us feedback and input on what you want to see in your Xbox, and for the tremendous support that you've shown us in our first year. We really appreciate it. Thank you very much.
Hi, it's Larry here of Xbox Live with Major Nelson. Here we are, live TV, Graham Boyd, AC Bongos. Graham, what a show.
How is it going, everybody? Absolutely incredible show. Do you know what? I love Gamescom. I love it. I love coming out to Germany, and I love this show. And that's why. You just saw why.
Now, right in just a few minutes, but right in these doors, we're going to have invited guests and media are going to come join us, get hands-on time with some of the games that were just announced. Now, Graham, you're going to take a look at some, and I'm going to take a look at some. What are you going to be looking at?
Yeah, stick with us. Seriously, we've got a great show coming up for you. Lots of live gameplay footage. I am going to be taking a closer look at Forza Horizon 2 with Ralph Fulton from Playground Games, and Ori and the Blind Forest as well with Thomas Mahler from Moon Studios. So cannot wait to see more of those.
I am excited to take a look at Sunset Overdrive. Ted Price, CEO of Insomniac, a good friend of Xbox, is here. He's going to personally give us kind of a walkthrough. Dan Ayoub, executive producer at 343, he was just on stage. Hopefully he's going to be running through those doors in just a second to get into his position.
Absolutely.
We're going to take a look at Halo, the Master Chief Collection, Quantum Break. You saw the gameplay.
That's right. You saw that.
That was unbelievable. First time. Sam Lake, I'm going to corner him and ask him some questions. I know I've been keeping my eye on Twitter. So we're going to ask him some of your questions, and of course I have my own. So, of course, we had some news earlier today about digital media support coming to Xbox One. Check out Xbox Wire or MajorNelson.com for that, right?
And lots of announcements in there which have been affected by your feedback on the feedback site in Xbox.com. So there's loads of stuff in there you're going to love. We should mention, everyone from the briefing is
right
starting
here
to file in now.
Yep.
They're going to get hands-on with all the games that we talked about in the briefing. And in fact, gamers coming to Gamescom will get hands-on with all these titles all week long at the Xbox booth. And we'll have more content for you all week right from here at Gamescom. It's really, really exciting. Okay, I think we're going to hand over to Larry. Larry's going to speak to Dan from 343 about Halo Master Chief Collection.
All right, here we are. Dan Ayoub is sitting here. Dan, you made it down. Good to see you. That was a heck of a run. This is live TV. Anything can happen. Now, we're sitting here. I've got Twitter open in front of me. I've got some questions, but show us what we're going to be seeing here. I mean, Twitter blew up when we saw this. This is unbelievable.
It's gorgeous, isn't it? Yeah, Dennis and I are going to show you Sanctuary
here
today.
Dennis is over there.
The lovely and talented Dennis Reese.
Yeah.
So what we wanted to show you today was give you guys a first look at Sanctuary,
right,
which is actually going to be playable at the floor here at Gamescom for the first time.
So if you're coming down to Gamescom this weekend for public days, you will get your hands on with this.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, as you can tell, first thing that jumps out.
Look at the birds! Look at them! Wow!
Is the bird. No, I mean, the map, we're thrilled, right? The map is gorgeous. This is quickly turning into one of my favorite. Like, we chose six maps to remake.
How did you do that? I heard you talk about six maps. How? I mean, with 100 or so maps, how did you decide that these are the ones we're going to do?
It was. It was interesting. Obviously, in many cases, people have their favorites, right? But there are some that are kind of slam dunks, and actually, Sanctuary was really big on that list, right? Like, this is just a map that people love.
Look at the lighting.
I know this is a spectacular map. Sanctuary was just really easy. When we sat down and started having the conversations, this was on everybody's list.
Right.
And I couldn't be happier with how it's come out. I mean, the team's done an amazing job. The map looks gorgeous. But in all of this, with all these changes,
we've been able
to keep the flow the same. So that map flow, the play flow that people remember, is almost 100% identical.
And I want to point out, you said this up on stage, but if you haven't, we'll say it right now. If people love this, they see all this, but they're going, oh, what have you done on my map? I want the old one back. You've got that.
You have the
option.
Absolutely. So whereas we chose six to remastered, the original versions of those
maps
are still there.
Yeah.
So get in them, go have fun, go to town. But I mean, you know, what's great about these multiplayer maps, right? You know, 60 frames per second, 1080p.
Oh, my God.
You can see the smoothness. You can just see how crisp and beautiful these maps are. The vistas are gorgeous. We've done a couple of other interesting.
It feels, because of the way the lighting is, it feels completely different.
It really does. And I mean, the lighting is even, you know, you saw when Dennis was coming around with like under the sun coming up in the bloom. You can actually, in some points, get blinded as you're looking up.
Right.
And, oh, there's something interesting.
All right, now, wait a minute. Any video gamer at home sitting what knows exactly what to do. It's red. Dennis, shoot it, please.
You gotta shoot it, right?
And what happened? Oh, look at that.
Isn't that. So this is one of the new things we've done on the maps.
Wow.
All of these maps have a dynamic element.
Okay.
So it's going to let you do something to change the flow of the map a little bit. So in this case, you shoot that, the waterfall is going to start to come over it, and that changes your sight lines, right? So you could be inside, or you know, you can have someone coming at you, and it just changes that flow a little bit. And we've got those themes. That theme is intact with all of our maps. There's going to be something that you can do to change the flow of
that
map.
Now, in this case, since it's a kind of a symmetrical map, does the same? I can see the red on the other side. Same thing happens on the other side to each base.
Okay. So whatever base you're in, we've got the water theme for this one. So in this case, Dennis runs over, blasts it. We'll see, his aim's pretty good.
There we go.
There it is.
So now, will the water keep going down through the entire match, or does it reset?
It will eventually reset.
I see.
And that adds some strategic elements to it as well. Okay. Sometimes you may want it, sometimes you may not.
All right.
But yeah, I can stare at this map for hours. I just love how beautiful this map is.
Now, I had
looking.
A question here from Twitter sitting right here on my surface. At WebbyStimp327 asks, what was the best part of making the upcoming game?
Oh, man. I mean...
Is it like this, being able to remaster things?
Some of it is this, right? I mean, a lot of it is weird.
Look at the water.
It's gorgeous, I know. I mean, everyone, we're all working at 343 because we love Halo, right? And playing Halo is what got so many of us into 343, and in many cases, into the business in the first place. So for us to be able to go back and take a map like this and make it better and improve upon it, it's just a tremendous privilege. Yeah. It's just a whole lot of fun, and the whole team's just having a blast making it.
There's more water, and we're going to go inside, and it just goes right through. Now, I mean, there's so much going on here. That HUD feels and looks so familiar. You know, we can see the radar, and I love the fact that you kept everything the same. I mean, even the waypoints in the lower left-hand corner near the radar.
Yep, absolutely. I mean, whether the multiplayer or the campaign.
There's the turret.
There's that turret. I mean, that was key for us, was that ability to make it, bring it into the modern era, but make sure that gameplay is the same. Because, you know, you've got your favorite memories of Halo 2.
Oh,
I'm sure.
I sure do.
I've got mine, and we want to enhance those memories. We don't want to take them away.
Right.
So that gameplay is identical. It's how you remember.
Charge that up. Charge it up and let her go.
Here we go.
Here we go, yeah. God, it looks so great. Now, this is a little different, because there used to be an energy sword.
Good
down
eye,
here.
Yeah. So this is one of the changes we made here is we've replaced the energy sword with the rocket launcher.
Okay. In this
particular map.
Right.
And we've had a tremendous amount of fun. We had some pros playing this
map.
Oh,
I want to see the Needler. I need to see Pink Mist.
I think we just passed it. Yep, there it is.
So there it is. Great.
I mean, what's great here is you're also, I mean, we're not hearing it now, but we've redone the audio as well. Okay. So you're not just getting these new visuals. We've re-recorded the weapon sounds, even like the footfalls, the music. So the game just sounds better than it ever has. It looks better than it ever has. And it's just an amazingly fun map.
Now, you talked about remastering, you know, obviously visually remastering the audio. I mean, how difficult is that to go in and kind of, you know, work on these iconic moments and the map flow and so forth? I mean, because you talked a little bit earlier, we were talking off the air about Max.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Max Hoberman, which some people may not know, but they certainly know his work.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you played the original Halo 2, you know Max's work. Max was the original multiplayer. Max Hoberman at Certain Affinity, who worked with us on these six new maps.
Right.
Max was the original multiplayer designer on Halo 2. So it was a great experience. As soon as we started this project, I flew down to Austin, and Max and I were just chatting.
So Max has his own company now.
Yes, which is Certain Affinity, located down in Austin. We've been working with them for years.
Now, what was it like to go to Max and go, hey, Max, remember that map you made about 10 years ago? How about you redo it?
It was wild, right? I mean, Max just geeked out immediately because we were just sitting having a drink. It was like, okay, Max, what would you like to have done? And you couldn't, either because you didn't have the tech or you didn't have the time or you didn't have the tools. And which is just great, because Max will just immediately start launching into stories.
Right.
And, and we couldn't do this, and we didn't have time to finish that.
Right.
And, you know, we just got into this amazing, great partnership, this great dialogue with Certain Affinity of things they wanted to do, things we wanted to do. And this is the result, right? You've just got a gorgeous map that plays how you remember.
Look at the walls
exactly.
there.
Exactly.
See the water just coming down there.
It is gorgeous. The detail
so
on this
luscious.
Map is phenomenal.
Yeah.
And I often say that I do think this is going to be one of the best, most popular Halo maps ever shipped.
Now, you said so you're going to do six of them.
Yes.
So let's talk about the ones you've announced already.
Okay, so what have we talked about so far? So we talked about this. We talked about Ascension. Dennis, what were the other two we've announced? I don't want to get into jail here. Ascension, Sanctuary, Coag Regulation's the other one.
Known as Blood Gulch.
Blood Gulch.
So those oldies.
We're going to stop there because we're both worried we're going to say the
wrong
one.
Totally get that. But, you know, there's going to be a total of six eventually.
Yes.
You guys, with hand-loving care, have remade these using the power of Xbox One. And I want to be clear, this is the first time that you'll ever be able to play all of the Master Chief games, all the Halo games, on one console.
On one console,
right.
On a single generation, right? Because franchise has been around a long time and it has spanned so many consoles.
Right.
So when we started working on this project, that was a big part of it. Like, how do we take all of these games and bring it to one console. It's a tremendous opportunity.
I see a reset here, so yeah, we're coming back down. Yeah.
And what's great about the Xbox One, we have so much more power to work with.
Right.
I mean, we couldn't do this before, right? Like, people get excited about all of the games unlocked,
right,
everything on one disc. And this is really something we couldn't do before the Xbox One.
Well, I got to tell you, I have not had a chance to get hands-on time with this game yet, because you guys are real busy. But I was downstairs where you're setting up where people are going to get their hands
great.
On and at Gamescom. People were geeking out over the menu system.
It's funny, you know. We liked it. We're like thrilled people are so excited about that menu system. But there's just something so powerful to people, I think, emotionally, just looking at it and saying, like, it's all here.
And let's talk about that real quickly. I mean, I don't know if you, Dennis, if you can back out and show it, but it allows you to go into different playlists, right?
Absolutely.
And so talk about that.
One of the advantages we've got of unlocking everything at the beginning
right.
is we can create some really fun playlists. So you can move through the game however you want.
Oh,
everything's
look at that
unlocked.
Screen. That's so beautiful.
But by having the playlist, we can do things like, okay, we're going to have playlists where you play all the vehicle missions
right.
from Halo 1 through 4, just back to back.
Okay.
Or, you know, all of the space missions or all of the Warthog missions. Or I think Dennis's personal favorite where we've just got start the first level at Halo 1, work all the way through to the end of Halo 4, just
right.
like in one power grind right,
right.
through the whole thing. So, and we're going to have more of those
right.
after we launch as well.
Right. Well, we're probably going to, you know, we don't know. Unfortunately, I just got the note here in my ear that we're out of time. So, we're, you know, if you're coming to Gamescom, just remember that you are going to be able to play this on the floor. You can check out the menu system yourself.
Check it out. Yeah, you can come. You can play Ascension and Sanctuary.
And the game itself. So you'll have Ascension
and Sanctuary playable on the floor. Yeah, come check it out. We're going to be running matches Wednesday right through the end of the show.
Yeah, this is unbelievable. So I want to thank you for coming by. Awesome for you to come from directly right above us and run down here to join
us. It's a nice run.
All right, Graham, you've got some new stuff going on right over there with Forza. Is that right?
That is right, Larry. Thank you. Thank you, Dan. And thank you, Dennis, as well. Dennis didn't die once in that whole level. That is some mad skills. Well done, Dennis. Well done. All right, I am here with Ralph Fulton. He is the creative director from Playground Games, and we are going to talk about Forza Horizon 2. How are you, Ralph?
I'm great. How are you?
I am good. Congratulations on a great show in there in the briefing.
Thank
Looks
you.
Looks absolutely incredible. I often try not to be too sycophantic here because you know I'm a massive Horizon fan. Let's take a step back first of all, right? When you came out the back of Forza Horizon 1, what were the first things on the list for you that you wanted to address?
That's a great question. I mean, I guess the first thing we knew was that the next one was going to be on Xbox One, an entirely new platform, more power, better graphics architecture. So that was a whole world of opportunity which opened up for us, allowed us to be really creative with our thinking around visuals, around Horizon beauty, around making this game more social, more connected. But one of the things that we really wanted to concentrate on with this game was to create a truly open world.
Yeah.
You know, make sure that there were no barriers, no walls where they don't exist in real life, and really give the player the opportunity to drive wherever he wants, to go, explore, discover whatever he wants.
All right, magic. And it shocked me when I heard that Forza Horizon took 18 months to develop. I mean, that seems like a bit of a superhuman effort. You know, have you been able to relax into Horizon 2 a little bit more?
There's been no relaxing. I could absolutely tell you that. Yeah, I mean, I think Horizon is an achievement that I'm personally incredibly proud of. I'm incredibly proud of the team. But I feel like we've gone on from strength to strength. I think we've really got into our stride with Xbox One now. We're really getting a hang of that as a platform. And I think the visuals and the gameplay really tell that story in Horizon 2.
Magic. All right, so let's have a look. You know, we've got this is the Gamescom demo of
That's
Horizon
right,
2
on the show
running
floor, playable
right here.
For everyone here.
Fantastic. So this is the demo that everyone coming to Gamescom will be able to play on the Xbox booth. Talk us through a little bit about what we're seeing here and some of the things we should be looking out for.
Absolutely. So we're on an awesome street race from the festival, which is now located in the south of Tuscany in northern Italy. It's one of the two countries we feature in Horizon 2. And Andy is driving the Lamborghini Huracan, I believe it's pronounced, which is our hero car, our cover car. He's driving down to the coast. And as you can see, he's on road, but he's also going cross country as well, because that's part of that Horizon freedom that we're trying to create everywhere in the world.
So Horizon has come to Europe, which I think is great news. You can see why. I mean, these roads are incredible. You've got a mix of kind of fields and vineyards, and we'll see some cliff roads later in the demo as well. What kind of choices did you make? Why did you settle in northern Italy and the south of France?
Well, you know, both the south of France and the north of Italy were individual locations we considered for the first game. Mm. Actually, and eventually Colorado won out. But when we came to consider where we were going to set this game, we thought, you know, we have a bigger world now. We have more power at our disposal. Why not throw a net over both of those areas? So we're in the south of France. We're in the Côte d'Azur. Then we go across the border into northern Italy. And as you say, incredible driving roads. phenomenal scenery, one of the most beautiful parts of the world, and incredible diversity as well, you know, and the types of places you explore, not just rural locations, but the city of Nice as well.
And diversity in locations, diversity in weather as well, right? We're seeing the dynamic weather in action here. Talk us through this.
Before our very eyes, yeah, we're absolutely delighted to be bringing dynamic weather to Forza for the very first time. It's something that we've really wanted to do. It's something that the fans have been asking us to do for a long time. We're delighted to be delivering it in Horizon 2. And you know what? It's a system which really leverages Xbox One, the power that we've got. We've built it specifically for this console, so it's really sophisticated next-gen stuff. We actually simulate the entire atmosphere, the particles within it.
Like rainbows.
Down to mathematically correctly modeled rainbows.
Good. Will there be double rainbows in Forza Horizon 2?
I cannot reveal that at this time.
Okay, that's probably a deal breaker for me, so we should talk about that later. But what implications does it have for gameplay when you bring in this the dynamic weather?
Right. So it's not just changing the visuals, which it does, you know, from minute to minute as you're driving around. It's also changing up the driving experience as well, as you'd expect. So it's Forza, so all of our 200 plus cars handle the wet differently. All the tire compounds handle the wet differently. And of course, it's changing that racing experience, particularly if you're in cockpit cam. You know, you have the rain beating on the windscreen, your windscreen wipers on full, spray being kicked up by the car in front. You're really getting a changing driving experience. It's very challenging and a lot of fun.
All right, very good. So how did we get on here then? Doesn't
Second
look
place.
Too good. I mean, I know we've got customization and personalization in Horizon 2, but that's probably
not
the type we're
looking for.
I'm not
sure Lamborghini going to be happy with that.
Anyway, let's get into what you talked about today in the briefing. The most social racing game ever. That's a bold claim, Ralph.
Right, yeah, absolutely. But you know what? As I said on stage, I think we have a feature set that really bears that claim out. You know, it's something we said right from the start of the project. Let's make, first of all, an experience which is truly next-gen in an online sense. Because Horizon is a social experience. Festivals, car culture, they're all very social. We want people to enjoy the game with their friends. So really our entire social feature set is about allowing people to do that in a way they feel comfortable with and in any way they want, really. So you could be playing asynchronously with people who aren't even online. Drivatars are other people's representations of themselves in your world. Mm-hmm. But then when you want to jump online, as we saw in that video documentary we showed on stage, it is instant, it is seamless. And we're trying to just knock down that barrier between solo play and online play and allow you to get into the action as if you were switching channel on a television.
You mentioned Drivatars. I wanted to ask you about that. They felt like a real game changer in Forza 5. How are you bringing them to Horizon 2?
Yeah, I absolutely agree. And I've told a lot of people about the day we switched on Drivatar technology in Horizon 2. And, you know, our races changed instantly, you know, because it's a very sophisticated AI system. What's happened more gradually, but I think is even more profound over the months since, is as people have started playing our game, their Drivatars now populate my world. Mm-hmm. And it's not just the way they drive, it's where they drive, and it's their personalities expressed through their cars. The cars they've chosen, the way they've painted them, the way they've tuned them. So every morning when I switch on my console at work, my world is full of personality. And that for me is the special thing about Drivatar.
All right, so which car are we going to choose this time? We've got an Aston. Looks good. Let's take that. Let's talk about online road trip and free ride. You mentioned them, or they were mentioned in the video that was shown during the brief, and they both sound great. Tell us more about that.
That's right, yeah. And really our goal here is to give people options in the way they play online. So online road trip is a very directed tour of the world. Everybody in the session is taken to a destination. They'll compete in a championship there. And when that's finished, the winner is crowned and everyone votes on where to go on to next. In online free roam, we really want you to make your own fun. So we make everything that's available in the solo game available online. So you can do races, you can do playground games, you can do cooperative bucket list challenges. It's all there. You can even go and find collectibles, hunt for barn finds with your friends. However you want to play the game, we're enabling you to do it with your friends online.
So let's talk about those barn finds and the collectibles. I mean, that was one of the best things about Horizon, in my opinion, just hootling around the world, knocking all those things off the list. They're back for Horizon 2, right?
They're back, and I think they're better than ever. So we've taken the opportunity to refresh those cars. So now more than half of them are cars you will never have seen before in the Forza franchise, which makes it extra special when you discover them. I guess the trade-off there is that with our truly open world, we have just so much more space to hide those barns in.
Right.
I think it's going to take you a little bit more time to find them, but you know, it's really going to be worth it to find one of those unique, never before seen in Forza cars and restore it to pristine.
Okay, so let's talk about cars.
We've got 200 in the game.
200 plus available September 30th for everyone.
All right, so tell me, you know, call out some of your highlights, your favorites. And some interesting stuff we're going to see.
So my favorites are the interesting ones. You know, I mean, it's great to have the Lamborghini Huracan as our cover car. I think people are going to be excited to play it. It's never been in a game before. We have some extreme off-roaders as well, as it befits our truly open world and the all-terrain nature of it. We have the Dodge Ram Runner. We have the Local Motors Rally Fighter. Really challenging off-road cars. But my favorites are the cult classics, the personality cars. We have a 1945 Willys Jeep. We have a 63 Volkswagen camper van. Mm-hmm. These are great fun cars to upgrade, maybe to engine swap, and then take out on the road.
And of course, you're getting all that amazing Forza detail we're used to. Can we switch back to in-car? As I know the hardcore Forza fans love this. You know, windscreen wipers occurred to me the other night. If you're chucking in dynamic weather, you have to think about windscreen wipers quite a lot, I bet, right?
They all move now, and that's it. That's one of the things that we have to do to make a car horizonified, we actually call it in the studio. There's a whole bunch of tasks that we have to do. We have to animate the windscreen wipers, and you will not struggle to believe that all of them are animated in exactly the correct way. But we also make the dash illuminate, again, as the real car will. We have to make it get wet, so inside and out. Our audio guys tell me that we have different sound effects for the windscreen wipers, whether you're inside the car or outside it.
Nice.
That's the detail we go to.
That's amazing. So let's talk about off-road as well. Again, one of the really important parts of Horizon 1. It's back, I guess, right?
It's back, and we're doing lots more of it. And the map is, I think, three times bigger in terms of the drivable space. Mm-hmm. You know, and that's not necessarily roads. That's fields of crops. That's vineyards. That's forests and hills. And once you get into the game, once you really get into the flow of it, we're really teaching you to go off the beaten track, to find the best route to wherever you're going. Forza has done a great job of training people to follow the green line over the years. We're kind of disabusing you of that notion a little bit and encouraging you to find your own route. And it's just crazy fun to barrel over hills and through fields going to your next destination.
And the thing we really have to drive home here is that you... Hey, we came first that time. Nice, getting warmed up.
He can stay.
So you're going to be able to do all of this in car clubs as well, right?
Right, yeah. So two great online features, which aren't perhaps your traditional competitive online features. They're more about socializing, meeting people, making new friends, we hope. So clubs is one. We allow up to 1,000 people to join a club. So maybe you're part of an existing social network. You can just transplant that into the game. Maybe you want to build up a massive club that can compete in the global leaderboards. Again, you can do that. But if you want to have a club of 5, of 10, of 20 people, it's entirely up to you. Clubs are a really flexible tool to let you socialize and play the game how you want. And then online car meets, I think, are really awesome, inspired by real-life car meets. Yeah. You just rock up at one of these meets in your car, and you're automatically driving into an online session with real people that you can chat to, you can share tips, you can compare your cars, you can race, you can all drive off into the online game together.
Okay. We can't talk about Horizon without talking about music. Right, such a powerful part of the first game. You know, for me, that Porter Robinson track, whenever I hear that, it just instantly takes me back to Horizon 1. What's the plans for Horizon 2? And, you know, what can you tell us any tracks you've got in there?
Yeah, well, we're going to be talking about the specifics of the track list really soon, in the next couple of weeks. But I totally agree with you. For me, music is incredibly important to Horizon. The guy who curated the first soundtrack, Rob DeBank, he's back on board. He did such a phenomenal job the first time, we had to ask him back. And this time we've given him even more license to be creative, to identify new acts, new songs. We have twice as many radio stations this time. We have twice as much music. Yeah. So there's just lots of diversity. Some classic acts, some classic tracks, but also some really cutting edge stuff, which is really just making it to festival stages and radio playlists right now, and we'll continue to do so after launch. And I think you're going to find lots of tracks like that Porter Robinson one in the new game, which becomes synonymous with this one.
Magic. Ralph, when will we be able to play Forza Horizon 2?
It's available everywhere from September 30th. It's going to be October 2nd in Germany, October 3rd in UK.
Magic. Thank you very much, Ralph. Really appreciate it. If you're coming to Gamescom, you will to play Forza Horizon 2 this week. Now we're going to hand over to Larry, who is talking to someone who I think you'll find very familiar. familiar.
All right. Thank you very much, Graham. First of all, I want to just get a shot of this. What you're looking at right now is that COD console that we just announced less than an hour ago right on the main stage here. This is the main floor of the showcase where folks can get invited guests and press can get hands-on. Wanted to make sure you guys saw that. But I am here with the creative director of Remedy, Sam Lake. Sam, how are you?
Great. Yeah. It's wonderful to be here, Larry, and nice to see you again.
Oh, it's always a pleasure to see you. Now, you and I were chatting because I was like, boy, there's nothing like live TV, and then you said, yeah, there's nothing like a lot being on stage with a live briefing. How sure. was that? That was exciting, wasn't it?
That was cool, and it went well. Yeah. You know, we were knocking on wood quite a few times because it's a live demo, and you know, those pesky Morag Solutions enemies were really hard trying to kill Jack and Oz.
Yeah.
But he did well.
Now let's talk about, for those, maybe some folks are tuning in right now, they haven't seen it yet, so kind of talk through it. I know we're going to take a look at some of it on screen
sure.
here.
Yeah.
What did folks see today? What did you announce?
Well, we haven't really before shown any action gameplay.
Yeah.
And it's an action game. So we've been dying to do that for a while now. And now we finally had a chance to do that. So that was the focus today.
I mean, you can see right here where things are kind of breaking down.
That's sure. Kind
of, yeah, I mean, look at this. This is
yeah, yeah.
There's kind a lot
of
going
key takeaways really with Quantum Break. Time is breaking down,
right?
Because of a failed time travel experiment, and our hero Jack Joyce, who gets blasted by the failed experiment, gains the power to manipulate time. So time breaking down, and with that, dangerous stutters in time,
right.
where time either freezes and shifts and collapses. These frozen moments can collapse, leaving you in a really, really dangerous situation. Or then you have just timelines caught in violent, destructive loops crashing into each other.
Right. Now, I know you and I were going back and forth on Twitter a little bit. You know, I was tweeting that you were on stage. We're going to be talking about a lot of questions. You saw some of the questions as well. So where do we even start? But what was the clear focus for today's gameplay and what you were showing? What were you trying to accomplish?
Well, really the core of the game. And this is a cinematic action game. And Jack has multiple time manipulation powers that he can use and the player can use.
Yep.
We have Time Rush, where you can dash through the battlefield while time is standing still. And obviously, kind of this results in exciting cat and mouse gameplay as you know, the enemies lose the track of you when you do this. And then they are looking for you, and you can surprise them. And you can kind of, as the game goes on, master that. Obviously, then Jack can also stop time in a focused area, freezing objects and opponents. There is also an added layer to that kind of going on.
Yeah.
If you shoot bullets into this area of frozen time, they become unstable, and when that frozen time bubble collapses, they get an extra boost. So there is an additional gameplay advantage there. You know, all of these time powers we start out easy and fun. They are easy to learn, but then we add more depth
sure.
and more power into the mix.
I want to talk to you, we only have about a minute left, so, but I want to talk to you about what have you learned from some of the previous Remedy games? I mean, it feels like this is this is taking a lot of what you've learned before and
yeah.
brought it into this game. So can we talk about that for
sure,
real quick?
That's very much the idea to craft the ultimate
yeah.
Remedy experience. I mean, obviously, there is a lot of story there, a lot of depth, but we love to talk about our stories, but this time around we made this decision that we are not going to do that. We are focusing on gameplay.
Right.
But obviously all of that's there and iterated on and finding the best pacing for storytelling in interactive environments. And then really, you know, taking what we learned from Max Payne gameplay and
right.
Alan Wake gameplay and you know, bringing some of those elements, but pushing it further.
Yeah, it's awesome. We got to go in just a half a minute here. So let's tell what do you want folks to know? What do you want to leave them with?
Obviously, we'll be here at Gamescom the whole week.
Yep.
We have a bigger demo.
Yes.
We are showing even more. So you know, on the show floor, look us up and come check it out because there is more.
You heard it here first. You're going to see more Quantum Break on the show floor at Gamescom. Sam Lake, Creative Director of Remedy, thank you for coming by. Graham, I think you're over on the other side. You ready to show us what's up next?
I am, Larry. Thank you very much. Sam Lake, what a dude. But speaking of dudes, I am here with Thomas Mahler from Moon Studios. How are you, Thomas? Another great showing for Ori and the Blind Forest at Gamescom.
Yeah, it was incredible.
How did it feel?
Absolutely incredible. We wanted to show some more gameplay this time around, and I think what people have seen is a really frantic, great moment in the game. So, yeah, it was exciting.
It was frantic, and that's a real counterpoint to what we saw at E3, right?
Yeah, I mean, at E3, we wanted to kind of like introduce the characters and give people a little bit of an introduction to Ori. But then, you know, we heard some voices like, hey, you know, show us some more gameplay, some more abilities and so on. And we just quickly wanted to show to get that out.
Okay, so we're going to do that. In fact, we have all new gameplay here today. Yes. But let's take a little step back first, right? Let's think back to E3. In the midst of what was a really bombastic, loud, explosive press conference, Ori and the Blind Forest was a real moment, right? It was a real feels moment.
It was incredible. It was so quiet in the room when we actually shown it, and the response that we got was absolutely fantastic.
Give us an introduction to Naru and Ori, right? So that E3 trailer was very narrative focused, it felt like. Yeah. Tell us a little bit about the story and what we were seeing there.
Well, Ori and the Blind Forest actually starts with Ori's birth, right? Like, I always like stories that have this great, you know, like, beginnings, middles, and actual ends, right? And you see this entire character arc. We don't want to give too much away in terms of, like, the story yet, but Ori is being raised by Naru and loses her relatively early in the story, but then has to go out and kind of like find out more about himself and about the forest that he lives in.
Yeah, absolutely. All right, so let's go and look at some gameplay. So this is brand new, never seen before gameplay.
This is one of the favorite sections in the game. It's the Chinzo tree, where we're also showing one of the abilities that are really, really cool in the game. Gennady just learned the Bash ability, and the Bash ability, as you see, allows you to propel yourself from basically anything in the game. Like here, you will propel himself from an enemy in the game, but then you also can bash yourself from anything, pretty much. Like up there, there's a challenge where you actually have to bash yourself off of projectiles, right?
Okay.
And then in order to make things a little bit more complicated, you can also redirect projectiles, and you see he is actually going through these kind of like gameplay challenges by completely using the bash mechanic. And that's what we kind of were looking for. When we actually started developing the game, we just made videos of hey, what hasn't been done yet in a 2D platformer before, right? Mm-hmm. And we just had a video where we saw Ori kind of like kicking off from enemy to enemy and so on, and that's what the Bash was inspired by.
Brilliant. And shout outs to Gennady, by the way, who's playing for us. Thank you, mate, doing a great job. So, you know, you mentioned there about things that you've never seen before in platform games and working on them. You know, there's clearly a lot of platform game inspiration going into Ori. Like, what kind of games have you looked at, and, you know, what were your inspirations?
Well, a lot of these 8 and 16-bit games are really what we were inspired by, right? We grew up with them, and it was so cool, you know, being at school the next day and talking about them. Obviously, kind of like the Marios and so on, that kind of stuff. And we feel like these kind of games, like that's a little bit missing right now in the industry. So we wanted to come out with a game that really gives you that sort of feeling again. So I hope that people get that.
That's a tricky balance to get, right? To get that old school, you know, that pixel perfect platform action feel, but then do something new and change it up a little bit. So that's a big challenge.
Right. But that's exactly what we wanted. We wanted people to really feel again that, you know, that this absolute pixel precision, and then also introduce a lot of variety, right? Like I love these games from Nintendo back then where they put in, you know, ideas that other developers would have made 5 games with. Right. And it's just really cool to kind of like look at the entire game now and see, oh my God, this is a big game and you have so much variety in it. It's great.
So tell us about the enemies that we're seeing in this level. Where have these enemies come from?
So this here is more of a kind of like a challenge area. So in terms of like the pacing of the game, we're always kind of like switching up between platforming and more puzzly bits, and then also enemy gameplay and so on. So we always want to make sure that the player always stays entertained, right? That it's not like, oh, this is repeating itself or anything like that in there.
Okay. So what other abilities is Ori going to learn as you play through the game?
There's a ton of abilities. We right. just basically, as we said, like we made videos at the start where we just wanted to see what hasn't been done yet in a 2D platformer. We don't want to give too much away. We want to stay focused on the bash ability because it's really, really great right now.
Oh, come but, yeah, on, that's Thomas. Just tell us some more. Come on. I know you're fine.
You will see more in the upcoming weeks.
Absolutely. I actually wanted to talk to you about your team at Moon Studios. I find it fascinating that this is being developed kind of remotely, right? Your team is spread all over the world.
Yeah. So, I mean, I've been working in the industry for some time now, and I've always kind of like seen this issue of, oh, we have this really great person and we want to hire him, but then you can't get the person because he's in a different country or anything like that, right? When I approached Microsoft regarding Moon Studios, I told them, look, I know all these great people, but they're scattered all around the world, and they were okay with it, right? And now Moon is basically a studio where we have people in Austria, in Germany, in Israel, in the States, in Australia, in the Netherlands, in Denmark, in everywhere. We just try to really find the right people for the job.
And it seems to be coming together amazing. I mean, me and my wife find it hard to make beans on toast when we're in the same room. So creating this when you're working remotely is ridiculous. And so talk to me about the art style as well, because, you know, the game looks absolutely beautiful. And it kind of looks different to what we've seen before. You know, there's a real kind of painterly aspect to this. Is that something you've been aiming for?
We like initially the art style, we had two major goals, right? We wanted it to obviously like look beautiful, but then at the same time we also wanted to make sure that it's absolutely 100% clear. Like, I like the Nintendo clearness, you know, when it comes to kind of like Mario, like knowing exactly which pixel you're actually gonna land on and so on, right? Yeah. So to me, like, I worked as an artist in the industry for like 10 years or so, right? For me, it was always clear that, hey, we would make something beautiful, right? But I think the thing that we're really proud of is that it's also always completely crystal clear what you actually have to do, where you're actually gonna land. Just this precision that, you know, that used to be the norm, the status quo, to bring that back, that was super, super important for us.
Talk to us about what we just saw there. I mean, that looked like a kind of mid-level boss battle. Are you bringing boss battle story?
There are challenges like that. I mean, in terms of like boss battles,
this looks incredible.
Yeah. In terms of boss battles, we wanted to stray away from the traditional setup of, hey, here's a boss, here's some character that we're introducing, and shoot him three times in the eye, right, and then he's dead. And you're gonna see a moment here, and we've seen it kind of like at the Gamescom stage, where we have moments that are completely frantic, that are completely crazy, where you have to use the abilities that you just learned in order to actually advance through the game, right? And we're doing this in multiple ways, a couple of times throughout the game, and yeah, we think that this works way, way better than the old kind of like, you know, tried, you know, fight kind of like trope of like, oh yeah, here's some character that you have to defeat.
Yeah, totally. It's big, so I need to look for the weak spot. One of the things I found interesting, I guess, one of the arts of making a good platform game must be choosing your save points carefully. And you've got around that in a really interesting way, right?
We came up with something very, very interesting, which is the soul link, right? Like, we initially, when we started developing it, we just kind of like had these checkpoints set throughout the game. But then we thought, hey, it would be much, much more interesting if we actually tie this to the resource system, right? To the energy crystals and so on. So you can actually in Ori save any time that you want, but it's going to cost you resources, right? So now as a player, you have to face the challenge of, well, do I use my energy for the attacks that I have, for the abilities that I have, or do I actually use it for the soul link? And the soul link is also where you can actually progress, upgrade, that kind of stuff.
Now, the E3 trailer, you know, looked quite serene. I mean, it got a bit dark towards the end, but we're talking about a real challenge with this game, right? You're really ratcheting up the difficulty as you go through the game.
It's not a completely, like, easy game, right? Like, it's a gamer's game. We are inspired by these games of the 90s, right, where games were actually a real challenge, right? So there's a lot of areas in the game where it's like, hey, this is actually a real challenge, right? It's not going to be something that you just, you know, cruise through, but it's so satisfying if you go through these kind of games and you actually beat something. Like, you walk into a room and you're like, oh my god, I'll never beat that, right? And then you try it, and then, oh wow, I did that, I'm awesome. That's one of the best moments that you can have in gaming. So
one of the other great things about those gamer games, particularly platformers, was the secrets and the Easter eggs, you know, whether they were intended or not. Yeah. Are you putting those things
absolutely like, there are areas in the game where it's like, where we kind of assume that, yeah, maybe 5% of people out there will find that, but I just love that. Yeah, you know, like we grew up playing games like Super Mario Bros. 3, where, you know, like you found the flutes and you felt like, oh my god, right? Yeah. So yeah, that's this kind of stuff we're super, super, you know, like we love that. So,
and in those days, you didn't have the internet to tell you where those things were, right?
Well, that's why we have to hide it even better.
That's right. I mean, I know this is a terrible question, but how big is the game? I mean, how big are these levels and these worlds that we're looking at?
I mean, the world is pretty huge. In recent playtests, we saw people playing around 10 hours. So it's actually, I mean, it grew quite, you know, by quite a lot. And we need that for that kind of experience that we wanted to create. We really need to feel like there's an open world, there's this world that you can explore that has tons of variety. So yeah, it became a really, really big game now.
And it looks like it would be actually a great game for speedruns. Has that been on your mind?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can't wait to see people actually playing through it and hopefully speedrunning through it. And we even want to do something crazy, but hopefully we can do something where, hey, the first person who plays through the game without ever dying once gets a spot in the credits or something like that, because I would love to see that. Oh, yeah, that would be great.
Thomas, last question very quickly. Is Nauru okay?
You'll have to wait and see when the game ships.
I don't think I could do it. All right, Thomas, thank you so much for your time. Thank you, really appreciate it. Everyone, we're going to hand back to Larry now for even more live gameplay. It's Sunset Overdrive.
Thank you, Thomas, and thank you, Graham. Ori cannot wait for that. All right, next up, I'm going to have Ted Price from Insomniac Games is going to be with me in just a minute to talk about Sunset Overdrive. But first, let's take a look at this cutscene.
How did you get in here?
I'm looking for a guy named Brillcream.
Troopmaster Brillcream is missing.
Well, maybe I can help you find him.
Maybe you'll be lucky if I let you live.
Kind of a dick, huh?
Treason! Arrest Forkim and banish her from the troop!
Chill out, Mussolini!
I am the troop master, and this is my troop!
Ah, man. Are you gonna tell me where Brillcream is, or what?
You wanna find Brillcream? You must do as I say.
What was that all about? I'm here with Ted Price from Insomniac Games, Sunset Overdrive. He'll explain. Ted, what did we just see?
We just saw the introduction to one of the factions in the game.
Okay.
This is Troop Bushido. These are adult adventurers, kind of like Boy Scouts, but they're adults, who during this apocalyptic moment in the game took refuge in a samurai museum, and they've now adopted the samurai code, so we call them the Bushido Scouts. They're a little twisted, and you can see their leader has an issue with his authority being challenged. But they're just one example of the many factions you meet in the game.
A little twisted. I like it because everything in Sunset Overdrive is a little twisted.
A lot twisted.
We're going to get right into the gameplay right here. So why don't we walk us through what we're going
to
see.
So first I want you to check out the character that Blaine's playing here.
All right. Blaine is off here on the side playing.
And you'll notice this is a different character than the one we just saw in the video.
Right.
You have full customization over your characters in this game because in Sunset Overdrive, we want you to be who you want to be.
Okay.
So from the very beginning, you can choose your gender, your ethnicity. You throughout the game, you earn all sorts of vanity to outfit your character in some pretty crazy fashions. At this point, though, Blaine is moving through the world with momentum. He is grinding, bouncing, vaulting through the world, and we set up the world so that you can move very quickly through it. We wanted to move away from the traditional cover-based shooting mechanic that we're also familiar with and introduce a new paradigm to shooters.
Now, I want to talk a little bit. You talked about the customization. It's important to point out that you told me earlier off the air, customization, that doesn't impact gameplay.
It doesn't.
Right. Why is that? Tell me why you guys made that decision.
Well, we didn't want people to feel restricted in terms of the vanity choices that they make in the game. And again, if you want to freely express yourself, you shouldn't feel like there are negative consequences for example, choosing the quote-unquote wrong outfit.
Right.
And in this game, we really do push it when it comes to style.
Right.
We have a few sedate things that you might feel comfortable in.
Oh, come on. Look at this shirt, will you?
We might have this shirt in the game.
I hope so.
But we also have a lot of very avant-garde fashions. Yeah. Now, something else to notice here, when Blaine's moving through, you see those lightning bolts?
Yep.
What he's doing is he is...
It's in the upper right-hand corner of your HUD.
That's right. He is earning style as he's moving through the game and doing more and more complex moves, such as jumping from wire to wire, bouncing on different objects, killing enemies while he's grinding or traversing. As he builds up style, he starts to activate amps. And these are special abilities that you can attach to your character, your melee, your weapons. We even have things called epic amps, which trigger at certain points and just do crazy things.
Right.
But there are many, many in the game, and you actually construct them. You craft them in the game based with stuff that you found. Now, also, you might have noticed that he just fried a whole bunch of these OD, these mutants in the game, by jumping on a device, a trap.
Yep.
That was one of our flame traps in the game. But throughout the world, it's very interactive. There are tons of things that you can experiment with, play with, as you're moving through the world.
Ah, here we go.
That looks like a boss. It's a pretty nasty character. And he's tough. And he, unlike most big guys, he's very agile. No matter where Blaine goes, he's probably going to be chased down by the Hurker.
Sure.
A Hurker can climb on buildings. He can throw boulders at you. Basically terrorize you. However, Blaine, I believe, was using the propane launcher and shooting bottles of propane at this. Well, now he's not. Now he's using the AK.
Right.
I would suggest that Blaine use a fire-based weapon because this guy is particularly susceptible to fire.
All right.
And all of our enemy factions are susceptible to various different types of weapons.
Right.
So it gives you a lot of opportunity to experiment with weapon strategy.
Now, I also want to point out that I know that the game is really about, getting up off the ground. But even if you're off the ground, that doesn't mean you're safe.
Not at all. The enemies will climb. They're very agile. They'll climb after you. We have flying enemies in the game, lots of projectile enemies, and it's varied. Again, we're trying to keep you on your toes and keep you moving.
Now, how far are this particular... I love this.
Oh, okay. You died.
Hold on. What? We get to see a respawn sequence, and there we go.
A little homage to one of our favorite games.
We know what that is. Yeah. Every time you respawn, you'll see a different animation. Now, I want to talk a little bit about the weapons. There's a variety of weapons available in the game, obviously.
Yes.
And you guys, we saw one that... Talk us through what we're seeing.
So, Blaine is using the propane launcher here, but he's also got at his disposal the TN Teddy launcher, which is something I mentioned earlier today. This is a teddy bear who's got dynamite strapped to his chest. And when you fire him out, he makes little cute sayings and he blows up. Very good to take in terms of taking out large numbers of enemies.
Right.
He could also use a flaming compensator, which is actually one of my favorites, a shotgun that will light things on fire. Great, super powerful short-range weapon. As you can see there, he just lit the Hurker on fire. Another good one to use in a crowd is the Captain Ahab. Oh,
Blaine.
You told me that you would be able to play through on normal, no problem.
And he respawns out of a phone booth.
All right.
That's awesome.
You know what? We wanted to make dying fun.
Right, exactly.
So just
But it doesn't hurt you. I mean, you're not penalized for dying, right?
Correct. You are not.
Right. So it's a really, you guys did make it fun.
I think it's important to note, too, this is an open world game. There are lots and lots of missions and quests that you will be going on as you explore this giant world and traverse through it in these unique ways.
Now, I want to talk a little bit about the multiplayer. We've talked about the multiplayer over the past few months, but can you give us some more details? Obviously, this is the single player, but give us some details while we're watching Blaine play.
So Chaos Squad is the name of our multiplayer mode in this game. You and seven other friends engage in a series of randomized missions through the same open world.
Okay.
So you and eight people are playing through the open world together, and the culmination of those missions is what we call night defense.
Sure.
When you all are getting together and defending these giant vats of overcharge from marauding OD. Throughout in those night defense rounds, if you manage to survive, you win some very cool prizes and rewards that you can take back into the single player campaign.
That looks so good. Now, also earlier today, we announced the console.
That's right. Pretty exciting. The white Xbox Sunset Overdrive console. It's amazing. And all of us at Insomniac were pretty stunned and just. It's a dream come true for us.
What's he have to do here? I mean, I've seen him play this. I've seen someone play it better, but
this actually does have a big backstory behind this particular amusement park. You are helping out another one of the factions in the game called the Fargarths.
Okay.
They are somebody we will go into more detail on later, but they have a problem with one of the enemy factions in the game who have stolen an important item.
Okay.
And so you've got to get the king of the Scabs, that's the name of the enemy faction, to come out from his hiding place in one of these towers. And you do so by destroying those towers, which he did, and destroying the railroad, the cars that were on the track. Here we go. King Scab. Nice job, Blaine. Well done.
Well done, Blaine.
Now, if Blaine wanted to, he could just jump right into Chaos Squad from his single-player campaign. Throughout the world, we've got Chaos Squad photo booths that you can step into and immediately join a party,
right,
and start a game in the same world,
yeah,
multiplayer.
So we announced a lot. I mean, we've got the customization, you've got all the different multiplayer elements. I mean, there's so much more to Sunset Overdrive, right?
There is, and there's a lot. We're always very careful to, reveal more and more as we get closer to launch.
Right. Now, I mean, this is, how would you describe this? Is this an open world game? We're looking at some folks right behind us who are actually playing the game. You can probably see them up there. So actually, you're going to have hands-on at Gamescom, right?
I believe so, yes.
Yes, we are going to have. So if you're coming to Gamescom for public days over the next few days, we will have hands-on. You can get your hands-on Sunset Overdrive, some of what you just saw right here. Ted, as you guys march towards the release of the game, which comes out?
Comes out in America on the 28th of October, here in Europe on October 31st.
And that's obviously also when the console will be available as well, right?
That's correct.
So there's a lot going on with Sunset Overdrive. All right, we have a trailer, right? Apparently we have a trailer, so we're going to show you this trailer right now. Ted from Insomniac Games, thank you for coming by to show us Sunset Overdrive. If you're coming to Gamescom, you'll have a chance to get hands-on this weekend, so do not forget that. All right, let's take a look at this brand new Sunset Overdrive trailer.
I've lost so many friends. Seen so much tragedy.
Joining the first people on the planet to drink Overcharge!
Sometimes I wonder why fate chose me to live when they all die.
Oh yeah, because I'm not a dumbass. My name's Floyd. I was a head scientist at Fisco, but I decided to leave because her health insurance doesn't cover this. If they had just given me a bit more time to research Overcharge, I'm sure I would have figured out it would do this or that. And I definitely, probably, would have caught that. But if you think their accidents are nasty, wait till you see what they're making on purpose. They've got eyes everywhere. And now they've sent in a legion of bots to, quote, liquidate their assets.
Fisco cover-up begin.
And I must say, they are efficient workers.
This is our turn.
You will die.
Go ahead and check the exceeds expectations box on their year-end assassination review. Oh, damn. And there's little old you in the center of all this. But you seem to be holding your own. And ever since I crossed your path, survival has gotten a lot more survivable. But don't get cocky. Stay moving and stay shooting. If you stand around, you're gonna die. And then I'm gonna die, and then I'm gonna put my ghostly foot up your ghostly. Go forth and enjoy your apocalypse. Have fun!
All right, everybody, that is it. Oh, I'm sad.
It's
that
went already past so fast. It was over so fast.
I know, that's what happens when you have all that live game.
We have all these great games behind us as well, but we are out of time, Grant.
Thank you very much for joining us for our Xbox Gamescom media briefing after show. It has been a blast. I hope you've enjoyed it too.
Yep.
And I hope you enjoyed that more in-depth look at some of the big titles we've got coming this year to Xbox One.
Absolutely. Now, don't go away because we're going to be here all week. You and I are talking about how much we love Gamescom. You and I are going to be Hallery, plus we have a special guest, right?
We do. She is so awesome. She has four vowels, count them, in her first name. It's
Aoife
Wilson.
All the vowels. How are you guys?
We are good. How are you, more importantly?
I am awesome. Well, while you guys have been sitting on your nice, fancy, comfy white sofas,
right?
I have been all around, okay? I've just got done talking to Peter Schmeichel, and then for the rest of the week, I'll be talking to all of the guys down at the floor. I'll be talking to 343 Industries about Halo. I'll be talking to Lionhead about Fable Legends. I cannot wait. It's going to be very
exciting. What have you seen that you're particularly excited about so far?
I am looking forward to Fable Legends, I gotta say, and Sunset Overdrive just looks like so much fun. That's so
right
much fun.
Over there. Ted will let you play.
Yeah, I will. I sure will.
Yeah, we've got time now. All right. I hear you saying, where can you see all this amazing Gamescom coverage?
Is where can you see all this amazing Gamescom coverage?
So I'll tell you. You can go to xbox.com/Gamescom. It's all there. And of course, on your Xbox 360 and your Xbox One dashboard.
Now, if Twitter's your thing, like it is for me, you can follow at Xbox, at Xbox UK, or me, at Major Nelson. We'll also have updates at Xbox Wire, news.xbox.com, and on my blog at majornelson.com.
I mean, you could follow AC Bongos on Twitter and Aoife Lockhart as well.
Do you write this stuff?
I mean, what's going on here? It's cutting us out
this
completely.
Is very biased.
This is unbelievable. All right, and we'll be live streaming all week, live and direct from the Xbox booth at Gamescom on twitch.tv.
/Xbox. Awesome. So that's it, guys.
That's
Aoife,
it right
thank you for joining us right at the
thank
end.
Thank you for
that
having me.
That was brilliant. I hope you enjoyed it. Have an amazing Gamescom week and stick with us on Xbox. It's going to be great.
Bye,
see you later. Bye-bye.